Babette Pettersen studied biology as an undergraduate with a view to a career in medicine, but she then changed tack and after INSEAD went into the chemical industry. She spent much of her career at Dow Corning, ending up as global head of marketing, and she is now chief commercial officer at a biotech startup. Welcome to Alumni Experience, Babette. How did you come to ditch the medical career in favor of the chemical industry?
Well, it started actually when I was at university in the US, because I had come from England. In the US, the university system means that you have a major. So I was a science major in pursuit of potentially a medical career. But you have to do other courses. So it's a fantastic opportunity to learn about economics, psychology, study French literature all through your university years, which is unusual. And having done that, I actually got into economics and found it interesting and thought, why not combine the sort of economic side of the world with the medical profession? And in fact, I was fortunate enough after INSEAD to go and work for a company called Baxter Travenol in the healthcare industry. And it really was interesting to see how still today, I'm sure, these companies, these large healthcare companies and pharma companies, the innovation, the research and development and the investment they do really do improve people's quality of life. So for me, it was a fabulous way to participate in that profession, not through being a doctor or a nurse or a medical part of the medical infrastructure, but really come from the business perspective in terms of new product development, bringing new drugs and new products into market.
You've spent your career in the chemical industry, especially Dow Corning. As an industry, what's it like to work in?
The chemical industry doesn't always have the best name in the general public, but it is a fascinating industry to work for. And in fact, chemicals are the foundation of many everyday products, the textiles we wear, the food we eat, the packaging that things come in. And one of the reasons why I stayed for a long time at Dow Corning, apart from the fact that it was an excellent company and I learned and I felt I was able to contribute, really were that I was able to work in so many different industries. So the common thread that was carried through was I was a marketeer at the out. I started out as a product manager, then became a marketing manager, economic evaluator, all the way through to running global marketing excellence for the corporation and being in the new business incubator.
You've had a lot of business development roles, and this is something a lot of INSEAD people do, but people aren't always clear what it is. Can you kind of define the role for us?
I think it's a continuum. So you have the act of selling, which is you have a product, you find a customer, you sell the product. You have the act of marketing, which is actually making sure that you develop a product that the customer wants, which is very different because you might not be making that product. And then it's a sort of time horizon. And the third horizon of that really is new business development, where it takes a little bit longer to develop that product or that product line that the market wants and needs in order to be able to continuously grow and generate profit. So there are distinctive skills in each of those areas, short-term, medium-term, long-term, but they are part of a continuum in terms of serving customer needs.
How do you sort of discipline scientists to think about what customers want rather than pushing research in directions that they're interested in?
Scientists are very bright people. And have a sort of natural tendency to come up with lots of ideas. So discipline is required. And something that I learned for a great many years at Dow Corning was the importance of business processes, which of course everyone finds dull, but to provide a framework for work to take place. And, you know, scientists, like everybody else, like to tell about their successes, but also like to hear about what actually customers and the market need. And that intellectual challenge to them is more, you know, what creative ideas can they come up with to meet those needs? Because they understand that those will actually most successfully move us forward. So the second thing that's important there is how you measure people's performance and scientists' performance. And years ago at Dow Corning, we went through this. Originally, it was how many patents? Well, of course, what you're encouraging that scientists to do is constantly innovate and create products, science and technology that maybe the market doesn't need. So the sort of second wave after that was, that's great, let's now measure the number of patents that are commercially successful. Well, of course, that changed the behavior. So it is about metrics, it is about the way we reward people. And then the third generation was, we'll measure the number of patents that generate commercial results within a period of time. So then it became time-driven. So again, it's a balance of the carrot and the stick.
You rose very high in this huge multinational. Do you need political skills to do that?
I think they are essential, but only partly, because obviously you have to be good at what you do, you have to have a good track record, you have to be able to work with people and lead people. So just want to point out that political element is only a part of that. And having lived in Brussels for 35 years, I can only draw a parallel with the politicians that I meet from time to time in the European Commission and the lobbyists. It's influencing as opposed to doing, leading, managing. And, you know, influencing isn't a bad word or shouldn't be a bad word, because one influences one's children to make the right choices on a personal level. So it is a skill that is a valuable skill to have. And I would say, you know, either one acquires it by experience, or I had the good fortune at Dow Corning to help by having training. You don't have political training, but how to influence decision making and how to lead people, and all that contributed to developing that side of the business set of skills.
So you've effectively recently joined a startup. How does that work in the chemical sector, which is so capital intensive? You raise this ton of money and then you burn through it trying to produce something amazing. Is it your job to sort of spend the money wisely?
It's a very important aspect of a small company. So it depends on how even the smallest of companies, even with five people, is organized. And at BioAmber, I would say it's not so much about burning money, but it's about raising money. So how much money can you raise? And I mean, if you look at the world that we're not in, which is the internet world, I mean, look what kinds of silly money, I'm sorry, that these digital companies are raising who have no revenue. So, you know, we're in the real world of actually making products, which, as you said, requires capital, a great deal of capital, hundreds of millions of dollars. And it's hard work. It really is. I mean, it is not for the faint of heart. So the activity of continuously raising money is all important. And the opportunity to separate that activity from the operations of the company is critical. So that there are people in our organization, like myself, who deal with customers, who build the markets, who work with the products. And there are other people like our CEO and our CFO and our VP of Investor Relations who focus on the financial market and the investors. And of course, I'm brought in sometimes to help with that, as is the CTO and so forth. But that really helps so that not everyone is all encompassed in that goal of continuing to raise funds to grow the business.